Ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, welcome to Lighthouses Live. My name is Francisco, and I'm delighted to be joining you from our studio in Geneva at the World Economic Forum. This is the second session that we are hosting today, and I'm also thrilled to be joined by my colleague and friend, Enno De Boer, who is with us in New York. For those who are not familiar with our program yet, the Global Lighthouse Network, it's a global initiative launched back in 2018 in collaboration with McKinsey & Company. It is a foremost community of companies that are successfully using Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies to transform operations and value chains at scale. Today, we are celebrating a new wave of organizations that are joining the network. We will hear from some of their leaders about their insights that lie behind their successes and how they are actually setting future trends. Enno, a warm welcome. Over to you.
Thank you, Francisco. It's my pleasure to be running this event with you today, and I'm so excited to see the progress of our Lighthouse community. Since the launch of the Global Lighthouse Network, we have uncovered the secret sauce of scaling tech-enabled operations within factories and then across the entire end-to-end value chains. We have seen the importance of putting an empowered workforce at the center of digital transformations, and we have seen technology drive new business models and deliver customer centricity. Now, we're seeing lighthouses use technology to power productivity and sustainability together. Manufacturing can be smart and green. Our new report, Unlocking Sustainability Through Fourth Industrial Revolution, highlights how this is possible. It showcases that companies are transforming manufacturing and doing this while being environmentally sustainable. They are in a win-win situation, achieving greater operational performance and making real progress on sustainability, not to put another mark against regulatory checklists, but because it's the right thing to do. Climate-related events around the world right now are showing us there's really no time to lose.
Thank you, Enno. So often we talk about increasing impact, but as you just said, our new report focuses on the opportunity and need to reduce environmental impact, on doing more with less. The Lighthouse Network has shown us how to use technology to power productivity across individual sites and value chains. And we are now learning how leaders are using technology to power environmental sustainability, which is actually fantastic. We are seeing sustainability gains in more than half of the lighthouses we have in the network. A few are doing more than that. And I'm excited to announce that today we are launching a new lighthouse designation, the Sustainability Lighthouses. These are members of our network that have reached the next level of environmentally focused efficiency in their approach to production, and that are setting new standards for the future. Enno, why don't you tell us more about these sustainability lighthouses and who they are?
Thank you, Francisco. I'm delighted to announce the three existing lighthouse sites that have been designated by our independent expert panel as the first cohort of sustainability lighthouses. Ericsson's Greenfield 5G factory in Texas is powered by 100% renewable electricity and designed with sustainability in mind, merging green technologies such as thermal ice storage tanks with their IIoT stack to proactively monitor energy usage and minimize their carbon footprint. Henkel's laundry and home care products factory in Düsseldorf deployed a digital twin that benchmarks 30 other factories to suggest real-time sustainability actions, leading to less energy and water usage. At Schneider Electric's Lexington site, they are using IoT connectivity with power meters to predict and optimize energy costs, leading to a reduction in energy, water, and CO2.
Enno, it is so exciting to see lighthouses setting new sustainability standards. And we will talk more about this concept, this new concept, later today. But let's now move on. And as we need to announce and welcome the new members who are actually joining our Global Lighthouse Network today.
Thank you.
We're adding 21 new sites to the network, which brings the total number to 90. Lighthouses come from all around the world and represent different industry sectors. These are companies of different sizes, and they are all illuminating the way ahead for our global manufacturing community. Eno, let's get started with introductions.
Arçelik is a multi-market leader in appliances. In Turkey, the site leveraged agile working modes and internal capability building program to drive a successful transformation of its refrigerator production. AU Optronics, a major producer of LCD displays in Taichung, the team deployed automation and artificial intelligence across their Fab 3 manufacturing site to drive concurrent productivity and sustainability improvements. You may be watching this event on one of their displays. CATL, a global leader in lithium-ion battery development and manufacturing, leveraged in their Nindu factory AI, advanced analytics, and edge cloud computing technologies to unlock improvements in quality while being more productive and energy efficient. CITIC di Castal, the largest automobile aluminium wheel manufacturer and exporter in the world, deployed in its Xinghang Dao factory a self-adaptive digital manufacturing system based on 5G and a flexible automation to achieve batch size of 1 and 0 minute changeover. There's a good chance if your car has aluminium wheels, it was made here.
The longest plant in Treviso makes bean-to-cup automated coffee machines. The site went from lack of competitiveness to manufacturing lighthouse by investing in digital analytics and a broad upskilling and reskilling program of their entire workforce. Flex in Althofen, the first lighthouse of this US-based device contract manufacturer, unlock higher quality standards and new revenue streams through digital transparency and advanced analytics that were deployed in the shop floor and across the entire supply chain. Two sites from Foxconn are welcome to the network today. The PC factory in Wuhan implemented closed-loop replenishment, having auto-guided vehicles deliver required materials to manage increased SKU and raw material needs. While the Foxconn site in Chengzhou, where tens of millions of smartphone components are manufactured, has deployed full automated testing and failure analysis system to improve quality and productivity.
Hyas Greenfield Washing Machine Factory in Tianjin integrated 5G IIoT automation and advanced analytics to accelerate product design, reduce defects, and save energy consumption. Henkel in Toluca manufactures laundry and home care products, and it's our first Mexico lighthouse, and leveraged advanced sensorics and digital twin modeling to reduce the environmental impact of their laundry powder production process. Innolux in Kaohsiung, a major manufacturer of LCD displays, implemented fourth industrial revolution technologies like advanced automation and analytics to improve its quality and unlock production of new niche products. You may be watching this event on one of their displays today too. Johnson & Johnson at their 6th and 7th lighthouse to the network. Both sites are transforming their customers' experiences. Johnson & Johnson DePuy-Synthes in Bridgewater is transforming patient care for joint restoration with their suite of digital tools to reduce the number of instrument trays needed and thereby the setup times in the operation room for hip and knee replacement. Johnson & Johnson Vision Care in London transformed their customers' experience with contact lenses through personalized packaging, configurations, and order automation.
LS Electric in Cheonggu manufactures power control devices such as circuit breakers. The site achieved mass customization manufacturing for a diverse range of electronic parts with IoT-based automation, machine learning power inspection, and advanced process control. Digital native Protolab in Plymouth, Minnesota, embarked on a transformation journey, taking it from a prototyping-only provider to a production supplier by leveraging its digital thread to connect customers to its injection molding production services. Sunny in Beijing countered challenges around complexity and size of rotary drilling rig manufacturing by deploying advanced human-machine collaboration automation to boost labor productivity. Saudi Aramco in Abqaiq, the largest crude oil stabilization plant in the world, deployed autonomous multi-sensor drones to minimize fugitive emissions of greenhouse gases and machine learning to improve consistency of crude oil quality.
Schneider Electric's 20-year-old electronics part factory in Wuxi confronted increased demand for product adaptation and order configuration with a flexible production line by using modular cobot stations and artificial intelligence vision inspection. Unilever's ice cream factory in Taicang, who says the booming business in e-commerce and big box channels with a one scan, one view platform to provide end-to-end supply chain visibility. Western Digital has two lighthouses joining the network today, one in Malaysia and one in Thailand. In Penang, the solid-state drive manufacturing site transitioned to a fully automated warehouse with centralized command center, while upskilling almost half of their workforce with zero job elimination. In Prachinburi, the team utilized operational data and Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies to adapt an automated logistics system for its hard disk drives that has reduced air freight costs and eliminated emissions from unneeded shipments. We have 21 new lighthouses. What an amazing cohort we are onboarding to our platform. Congratulations again to all of them. Francisco, over to you. Let's hear insights and reflections from some of our global CEOs from the organizations we just awarded.
Thank you, Eno. Let's go now to our first panel discussion of the day. You will hear directly from leaders who will share their real-life experiences when it comes to embedding tech-enabled operations in their organizations. I'm delighted to be joined by an impressive group of leaders from our global Lighthouse network. Rebathy Advaiti, Chief Executive Officer of Flex, Robert Bodor, President and CEO of Protolabs, and David Goeckler, Chief Executive Officer of Western Digital. Rebathy, Robert, David, a very warm welcome and thank you for joining us today. We have an exciting conversation ahead of us. We will discuss how you are shaping the future direction of your companies by leveraging Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies and empowering and engaging your people. Rebathy, let me start with you first, and many congratulations on becoming a lighthouse. 6 months ago, during our previous Lighthouse Live event, you shared Flex commitment to join our amazing global network of advanced companies. And today, we celebrate your very first lighthouse in Althofen, Austria. How important has been the role of people to achieve this unique recognition?
First, Francisco, thank you so much for having us here. And I'm so excited for Althofen and a site from Flex to be recognized as part of the Lighthouse community. A dream of mine personally, I grew up in the shop floor. I have manufacturing running in my blood. And for a company like Flex, where manufacturing is at the core of our company, this is a very, very exciting honor to have. The most important thing is we're a company of people, I say. We're 165,000 people in 30 countries. And I'm a big believer that culture is at the forefront of everything we do. And even great manufacturing comes because you have a great culture. So my belief is that Althofen's recognition as a lighthouse site is because they have a fantastic culture, a culture that's focused on innovation, that is very ready to embrace change, is willing to learn from other companies across the world. So it's such an amazing recognition for that particular site And it really opens up the avenue for every flex manufacturing site to really strive to be at the level that Altofen is and be at the level that the other 90 manufacturing sites are that are Lighthouse recognized. So we are very, very excited about it. We think that this is, you know, this continued start of using the fourth industrial revolution for all of us to really build on the capability of our sites. And this builds a sustainable manufacturing legacy for Flex. And so we're thankful for the recognition, but very importantly, we are really honored that our people and our culture is recognized for striving for this this honor.
Excellent. Thank you, Rebathy. David, many congratulations to you as well. Western Digital has also joined the Global Lighthouse Network with two sites this year, one in Penang, Malaysia, and the other one in Prachinburi, Thailand. In your lighthouses, we have seen success driven by a combination of technology and people. Can you share with us how Western Digital has been keeping people at the center of its digital transformation journey to realize its full potential?
So, Francisco, let me also thank you for setting this up. And it's an amazing effort and program, and we're delighted to be a part of it. And it's great to spend some time here today with my colleagues talking about this incredibly important topic. I also want to start by thanking our teams in Penang, Malaysia, in Prachinburi, Thailand. They're the first lighthouse in their respective countries. So it's just a tremendous achievement. It's something that the team has been really dedicated to and really, really happy with what we've accomplished. So keeping people at the center is actually pretty straightforward because people are the number one priority in our operations. I mean, we work in a very dynamic market, very dynamic environment, and we know that our teams are in the skill of our teams is really what's going to define our success in the future. So keeping them at the center is critical. And it's not just the operations team, it's everybody in the company. We have over 60,000 employees from the people in operations all the way to the executive team, and everybody is involved and behind this exciting effort. So really keeping our people, reskilling our people, building that future ready workforce is what's critical for us, but also our employees. I think, you know, any time in life when you learn new skills, when you educate yourself, I think you have the opportunity to live a better life. It's not just about our company being better and us being prepared for the future. It's about all of our employees being ready for that future. So keeping them at the center, having them highly engaged, all of the reskilling, getting them excited about what the future holds. You know, change is opportunity for everybody. So I think we look at it through that lens. It's not as if change is a threat. It's just the opposite. So keeping our employees engaged, and they've been the ones leading this. It's not been, you know, this isn't some kind of executive mandate. It's the employees leading it, pulling the company to it, keeping them all deeply engaged, I think keeps them directly at the center of what we're doing. And as I said, having our employees fully engaged, really building that future-ready workforce is going to be what defines the success of Western Digital. So we're really happy with the progress we've made, and we're really excited about the recognition that that we've gotten.
Thank you very much, David. It is great to hear about the importance of culture and people from both you and Rebathy. Let me ask you a follow-up question. What advice could you give to those companies that are still stuck in pilot purgatory and are trying to scale digital transformation?
Yeah, I would say a couple of things. So first of all, what we just talked about is workforce engagement. I mean, it's gotta be a pull. The workforce has to be fully engaged. You have to take the time to train and explain all the things that what success is gonna mean for everybody and get that alignment from the shop floor all the way to the executive team on what going to a new model is going to deliver. And as I said, not just for the business, but for all the individuals. Then I would point people to infrastructure readiness. You know, this is a new world. In manufacturing, there's going to be a lot of fast and big data, making sure you have a scalable industrial IoT stack that's going to be able to handle that and be ready. So, you know, first make sure the workforce is engaged. make sure the infrastructure is ready so you don't run into some roadblocks, and then really prioritize, pick use cases. They're going to have a big impact. You know, as the team says, think big, start small, and then scale fast. And I think if we take that approach, we've had a lot of success, you know, doing that. Picking use cases are going to have big business impacts. See, people see the value. You start to build momentum. And then once you get some momentum going, it's easier to keep it going and build faster and more of it. So again, workforce engagement, infrastructure readiness, and then start with some prioritized use cases. Start small, but think big, and then scale as fast as you can.
That is great advice, David. Thank you. Repathy, let me come back to you now. Flex Lighthouse in Austria was facing tough competition from lower cost regions. However, we know that your teams were able to leverage technology to build a more attractive product lineup. What are the key lessons your company learned from this? And how does it inform your future strategy?
Yeah, I'd say, Francisco, first thing is when you walk into our Althofen site, the first thing you notice in the Althofen site is, you know, the can-do culture of that site itself. And so as the world went through kind of labor arbitrage and manufacturing moving to kind of, you know, more competitive regions of the world, Althofen has been a thriving site, right, that has focused on using technology as a competitive advantage. And so customers actually asked to be in our Althofen site because you can walk into the facility and see that it's a world-class manufacturing facility supported by a very can-do culture from the organization itself. So you bring that together, what do we end up with? First is, I'd say we have a site that is very well-trained in terms of skilling. So they're able to skill and reskill, like David talked about, at an amazing pace with really good change, right? And the second is tremendous resiliency. So they're able to bring up new products at a fast pace versus any other site that I'm aware of, just because they have that spirit of innovation and the focus on technology. So pretty much any complexity of product they're able to bring into their facility and scale up for a customer and really respond to any of the market dynamics present, right? All of this has resulted in a site that's in Althofen, Austria, having tremendous rigor, operational rigor, lots of agility in terms of how they operate. And then the results have been incredible for that site. They have had tremendous revenue growth while improving margins. But most importantly, they have made some sustainable change, which I really love, right? So CO2 emission has improved significantly for that site, right? And we have driven reductions in terms of, you know, our travel costs and all of those things in that site just by use of technology, whether you're thinking about simulation or any of those other technology that has been used. So here is a site that really is a great example of you can be in any cost region in the world, but what differentiates you is your ability to be agile, to learn new technology, to really support customers in terms of what products they need, all of that built with this culture of innovation, right? And that is what the Althofen facility is able to achieve. And what I love about all of this is they already had great customer scores, and that went up even further, like 25% in the last year. I thought there was no room for this to get even better. And so that is just a great combination of things, which really gives me the hope that what really is important for manufacturing is a great use of technology that's innovative and a fantastic culture that's able to really support customers. And Althofen is a great example of both of those.
Thank you, Repathy. Amazing achievements. Perhaps I can ask you one last question. Going forward, how will you be leveraging Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies to power further growth at Flex?
You know, I think manufacturing technology is in a super exciting place, right? And I will split it into two areas. One is manufacturing technology, and the second is kind of supply chain, which has also been a hot topic right now for many reasons. So in manufacturing itself, and all of us grew up in the days of, you know, doing our simulation classes when you went to college and things like that. But today, you know, advanced simulation, having digital twins of your factories has become a given, right? So what is beautiful about that is if you have a new program that is coming up and a complex program, you're able to create a simulation of it. You're able to create a digital twin of that program. And you're able to ramp up with such speed and capability with less errors than you ever did before. It prevents people from having to travel across the world. It really brings everybody from every part of the geography together in terms of ramping up new products. So I feel like things like advanced simulation and digital twin are becoming less of a thought and a conversation and more reality in terms of the use itself. And then, of course, you know, automation, robotics, you know, the whole IIoT phenomena where everything is connected with some form of sensor and data coming out of every equipment so you can run it more efficiently is also becoming a way of life. I envision a future, Francisco. I tell this story often. When I was a shop floor supervisor in Shawnee, you know, I would drive to work at 4 a.m. for the first shift. And then the amount of shift change and things like that you had to do in the morning, right, was also tedious and cumbersome. I envision a world where using, you know, information and technology, we have seamless transitions in manufacturing. We have connectivity that really improves productivity and efficiency. And today you're seeing, you know, everything with automation, robotics, and simulation all play out, I would say. And I'm sure Robert at some point in time will talk about kind of additive and, you know, the how important additive technology is in manufacturing in the future. But I really see that things are changing for manufacturing. And then supply chain is a whole story. I'd say finally supply chain is waking up to the fact that it needs to move faster in terms of using AI and using smart technology to make supply chain more resilient. And I am really excited that even through this crisis, that conversation has accelerated. So the future of manufacturing and supply chain, I think, is in another pivotal point, Francisco, from where we are today. And we're going to see some amazing changes in the next decade.
Thank you again, Rebathy. Robert, this seems to be like the perfect opportunity to bring you in. Firstly, many congratulations for the recognitions of your Plymouth site as a lighthouse, Protolab's first lighthouse in our global network. As a medium-sized enterprise, you embark on an amazing journey to transition from providing prototypes to becoming an at-scale production supplier. And you did that by incrementally developing new digital capabilities. What did you do to further accelerate Fourth Industrial Revolution journey, considering your company was already a digital native?
Thank you for that question, Francisco. It's been an incredible journey that team has gone on and that our whole company has gone on. But first of all, let me say thank you very much to the World Economic Forum and to McKinsey for this honor. And really a special thanks to my colleagues and my employees at Protolabs, and particularly our Plymouth injection molding facility, for all they do every day for our customers, using our digital manufacturing model. It is due to their intelligence and their hard work that we received this award. So I really want to recognize them and thank them. Now to your question, you know, as you alluded to, Protolabs was founded over two decades ago with a digital mindset from the start. We began as an injection molding company looking to transform the traditional manufacturing process. Our mission was to automate traditional manufacturing in order to provide molded parts in days at a fraction of the price of traditional molders. And over time, we extended this digitalization approach to other services, including CNC machining, sheet metal fabrication, and 3D printing. So Rebathy, you're right. We love additive manufacturing at Protolabs. Now, you know, as our name implies, we targeted engineers in the needs who had needs for prototypes to begin with, but over time, we found that our customers were using us for production part needs and that they valued us for our quality, our reliability, and our willingness to make parts on demand with no minimum order quantities so that they could virtualize their inventory and reduce their supply chain risks, you know, especially in times when demand was volatile. So that realization was really key for us, and that launched the 4IR journey that you mentioned, Francisco, from being a prototype provider to now also a production provider. And to do that, we had to extend our digital thread, which connects our online quoting platform to the shop floor and to the customer. Now, we already had end-to-end automation in place that allowed us to make a mold from scratch and shoot molded parts in 1 to 15 days. But now we needed to extend that for these production applications. And so we adopted 4IR technologies to expand that system. And it included things like process automation, digital part inspection and validation, and process control, which included implementing an industrial IoT stack that allows us to conduct real-time monitoring of our mold presses and associated equipment, and then close the loop and all of that. So all of this expanded the digital thread and the digital twin of key elements of our production processes so that we truly had this end-to-end connection from the online quote all the way through the production process and to ultimately fulfilling to the customer. Lastly, we also implemented a scaled agile development framework, right? Because software is at the core of our business and what we do. And this framework allowed, you know, several hundred software developers who are serving our injection molding business to be able to be agile and coordinated at that scale to respond to the needs of the plant and to the customers as they evolve.
Excellent. Thank you for sharing that, Robert. It sounds like an amazing journey. Let me now ask you, what's next for Protolabs?
Yeah, thanks for that. Well, we continue to evolve, right? And right now we're evolving our digital thread in two ways. First, we're further expanding the digital quality and inspection capabilities that I mentioned before so that we can provide even more of that robustly to our customers around their quality assurance and needs tied to production. And second, we're expanding our internal operations now to include a digital network of premium manufacturing partners outside of our business. And this is going to be really important because it expands our offerings for our customers and broadens how we can serve them. And we're really excited about extending our 4IR technologies and learnings to these partners as well to create that larger ecosystem of digital manufacturing.
Thank you, Robert. David, coming back to you now, and I would like to focus once again on the importance of people. Your lighthouses in Thailand and Malaysia have several thousand workers, and you have focused heavily on upskilling and reskilling. In fact, in Thailand, 60% of your workforce was reskilled to support and accelerate technology adoption. And that resulted in zero job losses, which is just fantastic. How are you turning this approach of reskilling at scale into a competitive advantage for your company?
Yeah, well, so, I mean, what you saw is that our success is dependent on our people. Let me give you a little bit of background on what these people are building. I mean, Western Digital is a diversified storage company. And an easy way to think about us is 40% of the data that's stored in the world is stored on a device that our team built. So that's kind of an amazing stat. 40% of the data in the world that's stored is stored on a device that these teams built. And the demand for that storage is increasing at a 35% yearly compounded annual growth rate. So there's plenty of things to do and the technology that allows us to build it. And it's our responsibility to equip and empower that team for our short-term and our long-term success. So this is a very large imperative that we have this a workforce that's ready for the future that we're building. We have thousands of engineers that are designing the products of the future that are going to enable the digital economy we all live in, and making sure we have a workforce that's ready to build that technology is just critically important to us. And so it's really about making Western Digital the employer of choice in the regions that you saw. And that's about that stronger workforce engagement, training them, letting people know that when you come to Western Digital, you're not just going to do the job you have today, but you're going to learn new skills. So we're able to take our very experienced employees and our workforce that really knows how our business works and bring them into the future and at the same time attract new people into the business. And so I think it's a win for everybody, and it's been a great journey and tremendous success.
Thank you, David. Robert, can I ask you what your thoughts are here?
I would agree with David's comments. And furthermore, I would add that the manufacturing industry, and today particularly the American manufacturing, is experiencing a severe labor shortage. And this has potential long-term implications. A National Association of Manufacturers study indicated that, they're forecasting over 2 million manufacturing jobs could go unfilled by 2030. Now, as a digital manufacturer, we've worked to automate a great deal of our manufacturing process, which allows us to be more efficient with our workforce. And that's one of the competitive advantages that's coming to us from our 4IR initiatives. However, our employees are absolutely critical to our success. And so the challenge is real. And at Proto Labs, we're dedicated to creating what we hope are long-term career opportunities for our employees on the shop floor. And that requires considerable investment in creating learning opportunities that will help them grow. And so we've put a really concerted focus on upskilling our employees to ensure they're able to grow in their careers and develop the skills that are vital in this fourth industrial revolution. But for us, that includes things like in-house training and certification programs for key roles, like our mold technicians, for example. Online learning portal, right, that offers hundreds of courses that can help our employees to grow. Tuition reimbursement for continued learning opportunities at universities and trade schools. We really work to incorporate technology on the job so that where we can improve the employees' experience on the manufacturing floor and support their on the job training through technology. Ultimately, our goal is to ensure employees have a path to become experts in the modern best practice methods that we're using, such as scientific molding in the case of Plymouth, and also to grow other skills like A3 problem solving, change management, leadership development.
Excellent, Robert. Thank you. Rebathy, one final question to you. At Flex, we have seen your incredible efforts to reskill almost the entire IT team and your shop floor operators. They are all smart manufacturing experts by now. How are you thinking about fourth industrial revolution upskilling programs as part of your future strategy?
Yeah, I'd say, Francisco, just like Robert and David talked about this, I think it's core for survival of companies, but more importantly, it's core for our people strategy, because the best way to keep our employees, our colleagues excited about what they do is to make sure that they are at the forefront of every technology they use. I mean, I'll just give you a short example. Is if you think about, we have a facility here in Austin, and Austin typically made a lot of technology products, whether it is storage, security products, things like that. But recently we had to start moving a lot of medical products, into Austin. One is because, it's a fantastic location to have, but two is we also have a great team there. But for the team, they had to really change their entire mindset. They had to learn a fully automated, highly sophisticated set of equipment and how to run it, and really, pick up new skills that they didn't have before, including like FDA compliance, a lot of regulatory issues. But the team was able to, we were able to train based on other sites, learn from it, and really change, the competency of the site in the last couple of years. Altofen, the site that is recognized as a lighthouse today, has done that time and time again, many times over, right? So we have a system called Pulse that we deploy across the organization. And Pulse truly is the heartbeat of the organization. Altofen was one of the first sites that deployed Pulse, and they know real time exactly where all the product is, what is coming in, what is leaving, how much inventory is in the system. So they can give real time updates integrated into the customer system to provide them a seamless transition. So the idea of all those sites was, unless we learn first and we get to the table first, it is survival of the fittest and the best team wins, right? So we're able to really have sites that have the culture of we want to be the best, right? And what has been amazing about Lighthouse is we get the ability to benchmark and learn from other sites, then bring in and then really reskill our workforce. So, you know, lots of nuggets of examples of how, you know, learning and having new skills in manufacturing is the key. And we think about the next decade and how much more digital and automated the factory of the future is going to be with 4IR, as Robert talked about, that is going to be a very, very critical point of all of this, right? It's just reskilling workforce across the globe.
Thank you, Rebathy. To close out our conversation today, I would like to ask each of you to briefly explain your expectations when it comes to the global Lighthouse network that you have just joined, and on the one thing we should be all doing together to benefit from our community. Rebathy, can I invite you to go first?
I would say the most important thing would be continue to learn from each other. That has been fantastic. Other Lighthouse partners have shared with us, you know, how what it means to be a Lighthouse facility. We have benchmarked other companies. And so I'd say we're excited to share our journey and provide that benchmarking for other facilities and other companies. And so for me, it's all about sharing, you know, with companies and other factories across our footprint. That's what we're most excited about.
Thank you, Rebathy. Robert?
Yeah, thank you. I would say that the fourth industrial revolution, you know, as it has been driven by the digitalization of manufacturing and industrial IoT, you know, we really think about this as is likely the most profound transformation our industry will see in our lifetimes. And so at Protolabs, we're really excited to collaborate with and learn from our fellow thought leaders, some of whom are here today, right, as we transform manufacturing and global innovation together.
Brilliant. And David, over to you.
I think it's been said, and I just echo it. I think this idea of being a member of this community and an active member of this community, we really look forward to that. Learning from our peers, fostering leadership in fourth industrial revolution technologies. We're really looking forward to that. Learning from others, maybe contributing a little bit of our own ideas. And I think just being an active member of that community to transform factories and value chains around the world. We think this is extremely important to us, but we think this is, as was said earlier, this is very, very important to the world we live in today. I think we're all seeing this coming out of the pandemic. We're all much more dependent on technology. We're all more technology enabled and technology dependent. And getting this right is extremely important to the future for all of us.
Well, what a fantastic discussion. Thank you all again for your time and congratulations once again. Eno, over to you.
That was an absolutely fascinating discussion. I particularly enjoyed hearing from Avadi about how the Althoven site differentiates itself because of its team's agility, learning new technology, and supporting customers with the products they need. Our next panel is sharing insights about how technology can boost environmental sustainability and what impact this has on the overall sustainability pledges. I'm so delighted to be joined today by Jean-Pascal Tricoire, Chairman and CEO of Schneider Electric, and Dr. Robin Zhang, Founder and Chairman of Contemporary Amperex Technology, or CATL. Thank you both for joining us. Jean-Pascal, congratulations on your achievement adding another site to our Global Lighthouse network. Can you tell us a little bit about how you have used digital technology to create a competitive advantage for Schneider Electric?
Look, first, thank you for having me on this panel, and I'm delighted to be with Robin sharing our thoughts. For us, it's quite simple. Our company is specialized in digital solutions for efficiency and sustainability. So we are taking our 200 factories on our 100 distribution centers, plus all the buildings where Schneider people are hosted, as training ground for our technologies. We learn from them, we deploy in them the leading edge technologies that we are developing, and we make of every factory a ground of experimentation and sharing. So it's quite simple. Today we have already 30 net zero sites. We want to have all of our sites zero waste to landfill, and we are seriously on our way to achieve this objective because we apply digital technology all the time to everything we do. Every 3 years, we gain between 10 to 12% in energy efficiency. But we want to raise the bar as we go forward, and that's coming from our operational teams on the shop floor. We want to be zero carbon everywhere to reduce our CO2 footprint. We've taken the commitment to be carbon neutral in the next coming years. We are now really developing a strong, a big journey or deep journey in circularity, which again, where again, digitization is key because of traceability. And a collateral of that is to be net zero loss in biodiversity by 2030. So you are speaking about how this allows us to improve our competitiveness. Well, first and above all, we eat our own food. We test our own food. So we use systematically our own technology. And what we do is also to invite other companies to bring or mix their technologies with our solution for a better result. And one of the great examples is CATL. The fundamentals of sustainability are digitization and electrification. And as everything is getting more electrical, on more electrical based on green sources, we are putting more and more storage in all of our installations. So digital and storage and electrification are tightly connected together. And we embark, and we just have announced it, 90% of today, as of today, and it's going to be 100% of our strategic suppliers to reduce our carbon footprint because, well, most of our carbon footprint is with our suppliers. So a lot of work through the supply chain to make sure that we get better together.
Thank you. It's exciting to hear how you're driving environmental sustainability in your factories and with your supply base. Robin, over to you. Congratulations on joining the network. Can you tell us how you are using digital technologies across your production network and creating impact for CATL?
Yes, thank you for having me here today. CATL is honored to be the first battery R&D and manufacturing company to join this global lighthouse network. And I want to take this opportunity to thank for the World Economic Forum for their recognition as well as the efforts made by both of our teams. Without team, we wouldn't be here today. With the world working towards reaching the carbon neutrality, as you know, no, we are making batteries. The battery, basically, we want to be storage the energies, storage the green energies, storage the traditional energy. But today, we are working for battery is for the renewable energy storage in the future. So in the manufacturing, the battery is very complicated. We need a lot of digital transformation to ensure our qualities. In the past, everyone talking about defect rate, random defect rate is about 1 ppm levels. But today, in battery, we have to go to the 1 ppb, 1 out of billion. So the important thing is digitalization, artificial intelligence, big data analysis, traceability. And another thing is for the battery itself. If you put the battery in car, the car may last in 10 years. So you need a really long-term reliability. If the battery put into the energy storage for the renewable energies system, the system have to last 25 years. So 25 years reliability, without the digital, without the big data, without the artificial intelligence, without the analysis, simulations, and the traceability, we cannot achieve. We cannot make the customer happy and the world happy.
Thank you. It's so true. Improving quality will mean less waste and better sustainability. We're talking today about how digital technology is allowing us to improve competitiveness and sustainability. It's no longer a choice you have to make. Jean-Pascal, Schneider Electric has used advanced analytics to manage energy consumption. How are you using digitization across your 200 factories to achieve your sustainability goals?
It's certainly much more than energy consumption. It's about reducing any consumption of resources. by making everything much more efficient, and at the same time, by organizing circularity all over the life cycle of our products. And that's within the factory and beyond the factory, all over the life cycle. So organizing the whole chain of services so that everything gets recycled. So those are the two things. I think opposing sustainability on profitability is something which is gone. The reality is that sustainability is all about eliminating waste and making everything more efficient. And what we've seen is that while at the beginning there were quite a lot of opinions that pursuing sustainability would make us less competitive, it was actually all, and it is actually all the contrary, because that pursuit of being more sustainable makes that you are chasing any waste in anything you do, and you get a much better access to resources, which, take an example in the world of today, which is in full economic boom and where supply chain are under pressure, if you can operate with less resources, you are at a better competitive advantage. Robin mentioned it, but as soon as you digitize, you have a much better traceability, you have a much better resiliency because you can predict outages, and you have a much better quality on the first source of branding for a company and recognition for a company is an impeccable quality. So how do we use digitization? We believe that everything should be connected on the shop floor. So we have organized our system of technology so that our customers would be able to do four integrations that were not existing before. The first one is integrating the equation of process and energy into one digital repository, because you can't dissociate them. If you want to save on energy and resources, you have to act on the process. The second one is a vertical integration from everything on the shop floor to the cloud. It can be private, it can be on the public cloud, but as soon as you get the data, you need and you can have a set of functionalities, AI-powered algorithm that can really help you to go to the next level in terms of profitability. The third integration is the life cycle integration. Today, the life of industry is still very poor in establishing a bridge between the design time, the building time, the commissioning time, and the operating time. With a digital twin on the digital thread, you can really integrate all of this for more efficiency and organize circularity around your process. And finally, most of the company we know still manage their site side by side, building by building, plant by plant. And of course, when things are digitized, you can connect the connected into one unified operation center. You can benchmark, you can make sure that the good ideas in one site can be applied to the other one. And it's somewhere within Schneider, what is the idea of the lighthouse projects? I mean, get inspiration from the best deployments. So digitization gives you a scale on the scope for efficiency and sustainability, which has never existed before. And we are very excited by that at a time where, if you take Europe and US, where I get the statistics, specialists consider that the potential of digitization is below 20% today. So there is still 80% of potential in creating data, mining data.
Well, the scale advantage of digital is really impressive, and your work to scale across your factories is inspiring. It's an area where many, many companies are struggling. Robin, CATL's Nungdu Lighthouse used intelligent production and energy management systems to reduce production costs by 42%, and carbon emission per production unit is being lowered by 8.5% per year. How are you using 4IR technologies to further reduce your environmental footprint?
Yes, I think the most important thing here is you have to have an overall view of the whole carbon, you know, footprint from the mining, the cathode material, anode material, the supply material manufacturing, to the battery manufacturing, the carbon footprints, up to the battery usings, and in the future, the recycling of the batteries. So put everything in your mind as a whole system, then you think about how to divide and conquer each things. So you have to do it by yourself first, your parts. Our part, like a theater part, we are buying the supply materials and then we put into there to make a battery. And in this design, when the battery design, you think about what kind of energy needed. If you can use the innovation technology to reduce the energy, for example, we do the formation of the batteries. Your battery need to charge the electric. If you go to the fully charge of the battery, you consume a lot of energies. But if you have a good simulation, you understand what kind of charging is enough for the battery's performance. You can just go maybe half charge of the battery first. So at the end of the day, when the battery into your system, the customer can charge it fully. That kind of technology in design, you can try to reduce the energy consumption of the batteries. And the second, in all the process, you have a lot of innovation come out. For example, how do you recycle your energies in the process, or recycle your electricity in your discharge process, and recycle all the materials which really can reuse to the sustainability. So basically it's a divide and conquer, and after reuse everything, you can combine the whole system and a rule. Then you, with this kind of engineering methodology, you do by yourself in your factory first, then apply to all your own factories, then use this concept, use this some measures, some systems to help our supplier to also build this kind of really low energy efficient process to improve to very high energy efficient, and also help a supplier to make energy to be the green, and to also save money, it means cost. You save energy, it means you already have sustainable environment. On the other hand, in the digitalizations, you deliver one battery, you better with not only the one physical parts, you better to have a digital battery, which everything is a digital products. So physical products plus digital product together, it means really a product, already a whole product. This one is customer, our customer really like it because with this digital product, they can put this digital products into their, how to say, artificial simulations to see what kind of performance, what kind of things, adjustments. Then delivery, not only the physical delivery plus digital product. That's our concept to serve our customer. Then customer also very happy to see with this digital product, if we can do something, we can reduce the carbon footprints. Then you real make a physical product, then really you can meet the target. So in this, along this line, everyone can contribute. But with digital, with the mind of the energy saving from design to manufacturing, then we will help this industry to be a higher level, sustainable and green.
Thank you, Robin. I love your holistic and end-to-end approach to reduce carbon footprint and including the recycling. How do you not only digitize your production, but also with the digital battery are able to manage the entire life cycle? That is really impressive. Now, the Schneider Electric Lighthouse in Wuxi was tackling diverse customization and segmentation needs. You have answered that with flexible automation and analytics and also deploying a digital twin to improve energy efficiency. As a result, you have achieved 23% energy reduction, and at the same time, you're driving down unit cost by 19%. Jean-Pascal, what are the most exciting opportunities to drive both sustainability and competitiveness that you have seen?
I was saying we are monitoring that. We say, where is the supplementary potential from where we are today? It's probably still 85% of potential gains which have not been explored. So we are just at the beginning of the curve of digitization. I would take an analogy. I remember when I got my first internet line, I was living in China at that time in the 90s. And that changed a lot in my life, right? The way to communicate and then the way to hail a taxi or cab, or it changed everything. I would say we are in the internet of things where we used to be in the internet of people in the 90s. So it's just the beginning of a journey. When you look at what is the potential as we go forward, you're going to see more and more, as I said it, and Robin said it, more and more connected objects. Everything will have a part of digital. Everything will have a digital twin. Generating a lot of data, which will open and which is already opening the door to many, many new things. Like you can make your 3D design of a factory alive. Before there was a design 3D, and then you had an operation system. Now it's the same, at least with Schneider, the same digital thread. You take your 3D model and it goes into a live mode, and then you enrich your design for the next factory. You can commission much faster the factory. In the old way of doing, probably 30% of the cost of any CapEx project is reconstruction because you were wrong in designing things. If you have digitized that before, you reduce that to really the bare minimum. And what's really important is that each of those objects then becoming connected, you can really confront the reality of the operation to the intention of the design and make it better for the following. So where we see the potential is flat architectures where the world of operation is directly connected to the world of information and to the digital twin. So probably less of those mid-level architectures, which are today a barrier between raw data from the shop floor to the analytics onto the dispositive on the top, on really a different way to manage our processes. As we get data in real time and we learn in real time for all the modifications, we have to be more agile in the way we manage our processes, but be even more rapid in the way we react to data and in the way we modify our processes. The third point, and I'm speaking at a time where I think our supply chains are under extreme tensions because of the strong demand, we all realize that we are all intertwined, right? We are all linked to each other. At Schneider, 70% of what we do is with our suppliers. There are excellent companies specialized in plastics, in electronics, in every kind of specialty. And this digitization is creating a full transparency over the value chain, which is important for everything. Circularity, quality, of course, sustainability, and resilience. If we would all have more transparency about the depths of what our upstream chain is doing and downstream chain is doing, then we would be as a complete value chain much better for our end customers. So this is everything that digitization brings, but probably the biggest value is the fact that you don't think only on the perimeter of your own company, but you extend it to the extended company, which is all the perimeter of your suppliers and integrators.
So 85% of the potential gains have not been exploited. To hear this from our front runners is very promising and should remind us all that the digital transformation is much more than deploying a few use cases. Robin, that brings me to the topic of your global traceability system. You can track batteries from raw material all the way through to the individual vehicle where they are built in a matter of minutes. Wow. This obviously gives you an efficiency, but also it allows you to manage recycling. What are the most exciting things you are seeing?
Yeah, I think the most exciting things here is quality have been designed in the manufacturing. It's not by inspection, but digital technology help you in the design stage, how to do the battery planning, design quality planning. And in the manufacturing stage, because you have the monitoring, you have a real-time monitoring. For example, every battery we have very critical 3,600 critical point traceable data. All this data from supplier to the battery manufacturing to the user. Then the user is very important in the pack. So in the pack, the battery they have, we call a BMS, battery management systems. It's a real-time monitor the batteries to see what batteries problems. For example, this battery has been experiencing very fast charge or experiencing a high current or experiencing some shock vibrations or experiencing some water leakage. For example, if you have some problem in the water going inside the pack, all this data monitoring become a big data. Then using our modeling, you can understand this battery, how long can it last? How much value will be remained? How healthy is the battery. So we call it state of the healthy of the whole batteries. Then actually this data can use to be a judgment on the remain value of these batteries. All these batteries have to be come back to do the recycles. So traceability is very important to judge the value of these batteries. Then using our modeling plus our data collections, and then we trace back everything with digital data, big data, data mining. Then the methodology applied in, then very exciting to see. It's like, my car have a battery. Then I see this battery can last maybe 2 more years. Then I have to sell the battery out. If this battery, not bad, maybe another 5 years. So the value of the battery, remain value is different. Then if the battery can only last in 2 months or 1 month, then we go ahead to put the battery to recycles. Then let's see, because the battery material is traceable, then you understand this battery, what kind of good material is inside, what kind of valuable material inside, how to recycle this better. You can recycle the cathode material, go into the metal, or just cathode materials. Or you can recycle the anode material, partial or 100%. That kind of judgment all come from this data analysis and also the traceabilities. This can ensure the final customers the value of the products and also safety, reliability, all such kind of things. So I'm very excited on that. With digital transformation, you can know not only the safety, quality, reliability, and the values.
Great insights on sustainable digital manufacturing. Let us now turn to another topic on the mind of global leaders in production. It's people. How do we make sure people are at the center of a transformation? Jean-Pascal, can we start with you? How do you see this?
If in your company you don't have a sustainability agenda and a digital agenda, it's going to be very difficult to attract talented people. Anybody, young, older, or more experienced, let's say, are today very sensitive to the commitment of company to a larger purpose and to a sound purpose for the world. So the first thing is that if you don't have those two agenda, you're probably not attractive for great people. And Schneider, we say that great people make a great company. Every community starts by the right people to start with. Then after, I kind of touch that, but I've always believed that people make the difference, and every technology is at the service of people. So systems we develop, some people say AI will augment people. I just think the contrary. What we are doing is build systems which, thanks to AI, are taking care of all the tedious tasks, the ones which are just data crunching, automated, and we skill up our people who know very well the process because they come from processes which were much less digital, much less automated, but they know on the tip of their finger their product, what it means in terms of qualities, they know on the tip of their finger what makes the difference on the process. And we want our people to focus on what creates the added value in this chain of manufacturing. So if you rewind 15 or 20 years ago, would it be in China, would it be in Europe, or would it be in the US? A process was a lot of workers assembling components together. So I see a future where, one, that digitization has to be driven not by a central service because they are too remote from the reality of operation, but by people on the ground. And second, where we focus the added value of the people on the most important task, which is to direct the whole factory key parameters, and then automation, AI, and algorithm take care of the rest.
Thank you, Robin. Over to you.
Okay, my understanding of digital transformation is to promote by people to people. It is all about helping people to work more efficiently, effectively, and more importantly, easily. Because of digital transformation, AI always help you to some simple, repeatable things they can do that. So it's really serve the people, make the work more easy. So we have to train our people to be how to manage this machine, how to manage this AI, how to manage this digital transformations. So training for people is also important. But most importantly is all their tools. They are helping people to make it work easily.
Thank you, Jean-Pascal. Thank you, Robin. Amazing insights that hopefully will inspire our audience to accelerate their sustainability agenda. Such an honor to hear directly from the CEOs of our lighthouses about how they are bringing Fourth Industrial Revolution technologies to their organizations and the impact they are having. Many thanks to all of them for taking the time to share their insights. Throughout today's discussion, you will have seen a recurring theme of bringing environmental sustainability to operations powered by digitization. The United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change recently declared its finding a code red for humanity. There's an imperative for us to act now. We are calling upon each of you to use the examples of the lighthouses in your own organizations within single sites and across the value chain to begin your digitization journey and be part of the Fourth Industrial Revolution, to empower your workforces, to bring new business models, to power growth, productivity, and environmental sustainability with tech-enabled operations.
Thank you, Eno. The time has come to bring this session to a close. Many congratulations again to all our new lighthouses, and also to the three lighthouses who have been designated as sustainability lighthouses. And of course, let me also thank Eno in New York and all our colleagues at the World Economic Forum and McKinsey for their amazing dedication and hard work, which makes all this possible.
Francisco, thank you to you as well and to our audience for taking time out of your busy schedules to join our Lighthouses live event. We close the day with 90 lighthouses in our network and the new designation of three sustainability lighthouses. What an amazing achievement. I hope our audience feels inspired by the possibilities all of the lighthouses have shown us today. These 90 lighthouse sites offer us a blueprint to scale digital adoption and answer some of the most pressing challenges of our time.
I'm certainly inspired. However, we still have a lot of work to do. There are millions of facilities and companies around the world that we want to reach and engage in the unique learning opportunity the Global Lighthouse Network provides. Our network will continue to grow, and we invite you all to reach out to us to be able to experience the journey towards becoming a lighthouse. Thanks again to all for joining our final session today. Stay engaged in this exciting journey and reach out to us if you want to learn more. Bye for now.